I was asked yesterday, Pastor, how can it be God is all good, no? Yes? God is all good? And how can it be that evil be magnified? How can it be that 2% of our chocolate-loving Chattambitharam be made 2,000 if God is all good? What's the answer? Do you want to know the answer or you want to understand the answer? Understanding is up to God. I can teach you. Let's go to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, verse 22. Then the Lord God said, Behold, the man has become like one of us, to know good and evil. So what is God like? Oh, that's what you know. Understanding is completely, entirely different. And that I will teach you later, as the Lord leads. There's a lot of weird teachings that are going on. That's why I'm exposed to this. You want to know what one of the teachings is? What does it say? The Lord God, behold, man has become like one of us. It wasn't man already created in the image of God? So then what is this? Yeah, that's already there. That's right. But why does he say one of us now? Because he's already created in the perfect image of God, no? So the only explanation they say, which is not true, is that part of the Godhead involves Satan. This is a lie. Don't believe this. Yeah, but still, good and evil. You can say that, but there are 1,000 arguments I can put up. Then if he's a created being, explain, is God evil? Then who is evil ascribed to? Satan, isn't he? But yet here you have the Godhead saying one of us. Do you understand? You can go intellectually arguing that. That's why I spoke about apologetics now. Do you understand? And if you look at Star Wars, this is the philosophy that they are trying to bring out. There's a good side of the Force and the dark side of the Force. If you look at Eastern philosophy, there's a yin and a counterbalancing yang. Trust me, these people have been exposed to things we have not. And when it comes to confrontation with them, unless the Holy Spirit illuminates a word to us, we will not be able to stand. You know, let's go to Acts. Acts chapter, I believe it is 7, I think. Or 6, I believe. Yeah. Chapter 6, verse 8. It says, And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. Then there arose some from what is called the synagogue of the freedmen, Syrians, Alexandrians, and those from Sicilia and Asia, disputing with Stephen. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit with which or by which he spoke. And what are we talking about before we came to this? Understanding. See, to actually talk to someone. Look at what Stephen is doing. He's defending his faith against people who have no desire for the faith, but just to put him down. There is one category like that. Do you understand? and he was able to overcome that. Why? Because he had what? Wisdom and? Okay. Wisdom and? Spirit is S capitalized?
Yes.
So, what is wisdom? No. What is wisdom? It is the knowledge that God gives, isn't it? What knowledge is that? The Word of God, no? He knew his Bible. And from that, he didn't just start by picking and, you know, choosing as he thought. God, the Holy Spirit, filled him and he spoke and they couldn't resist it. Do you understand? Yes? So that's why I was talking about apologetics, about debating. Don't get into debates. Nobody is won by a debate. Show me in the Bible where somebody is won by the debate. Who had the most wisdom before Christ? Solomon. And you find that the Queen of Sheba comes and she's like just blown over. But, you know, it's like, wow, I didn't even know half of this. And she talks and talks. And if you read the passage, let's go there. I believe it's in 2 Chronicles 9, 1 to 8. 2 Chronicles 9, 1 to 8. So, we're going into another aspect of this now. But did you understand the first part about the anointing within and the anointing outside? Now, we're talking about the amplification and how you need to be careful about what's inside, isn't it? Yes? Now, let's look at this. 2 Chronicles 9, 1 to 8, and I believe I'll read from the New Living Translation. Can you tell her to be quiet, please? When the Queen of Sheba heard Solomon's fame, she came to Jerusalem to test him with hard questions. She arrived with a large group of attendants and a great caravan of camels loaded with spices, large quantities of gold and precious stones, and what? I lost my place. That's why I'm asking what? Precious jewels, gold and precious jewels. Okay. When she met Solomon, she talked with him about everything she had in her mind. And Solomon answered, and Solomon had answers for all her questions. Nothing was too hard for him to explain to her. When the Queen of Sheba realized how wise Solomon was, and when she saw the palace he had built, she was overwhelmed. She was so amazed at the food on his table, the organization of his officials, and the splendid clothing, the cupbearers and their robes, and the burnt offerings that Solomon made at the temple of the Lord. She explained to the king, "Everything I heard in my country about your achievements and wisdom is true. I didn't believe what was said until I arrived here and saw it with my own eyes. In fact, I had not heard half of your great wisdom. It is far beyond what I was told. How happy your people must be. What a privilege for your officials to stand here day after day listening to your wisdom. Praise the Lord your God who delights in you and has placed you on the throne as king to rule for him." What did that wisdom do? Show them, show Sheba that there is a God in heaven and only he could have done this. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yes? That's true apologetics. That's when you defend your faith. Do you understand? Not when somebody in Facebook does something and you get irritated. You never defend your faith on social media. It's always one-on-one. Huh? Okay. All right. Let's go then to 15. 1 Peter 3:15.
Lord God, in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good
conscience. No, that's fine. So that's enough. That's enough. I didn't say no. Say sanctify God in your heart. Give a reason for your defense, always being ready to make defense to everyone who asks you to give your an account for the hope that is in you, right? In other words, when all hell is breaking loose, and you're calm, they want, they're like, what's the reason you're so hopeful? That's when you're called to give. That is one. Secondly, when it seems foolish to hold on to believing in Jesus, when we know that the law is passed, that if you believe in it, you must be put to death. What's that hope that you have? Then you give them. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah? But it talks about being gentle, not argumentative, that some may be won over. Do you understand? See, there are those who will always resist the gospel. Not everybody is going to heaven. Get that into your system. Even the Stoics and Epicureans, when after she started talking about in Acts 17, Paul starts with the creator of heaven and the earth and works all the way down to Jesus and his resurrection from the dead. They're like, oh, resurrection from the dead? This is interesting. You come back tomorrow. Because, you know, you talked enough today and you need to go home and have tea. That's not there. I'm just telling you. And the Bible says some of them believed, some of them did not believe. Not everybody will believe. Your job is to present with gentleness, with love. Furthermore, the underlying factors are with what? Wisdom and the anointing of the Holy Spirit from within, who has taught you what you need. See, that's the whole thing. You don't argue where the sand in Jerusalem came from on Facebook. You don't argue the validity of the Bible as a written word of God on Facebook. What are you called to be the witness of? The resurrection of Jesus in your life, no? You were a bad girl once, now you are a good girl. You were a chattambi once, now you are less of a chattambi. Yes? Do you understand? I was a rascal once, now I'm a saint, praise the Lord. Saint John, huh? Yes, praise the Lord. That witness one-on-one when you bear, that's where you defend your faith and the hope that you have. Not like somebody posts something and, you know, you're like, hey, that's not right, you know. You get involved in Facebook, in the internet, every fool has a voice. Why get in there with them? Do you understand what I'm saying? You will lose your peace, you will lose your joy, and you will get it from me if you come to me and say, Pastor, can you get involved? Do you understand? Seriously. Did God call me to go answer every fool in his folly? Yes, you do need to defend your faith. By that, give a reason of the hope that you carry. The hope that you have. Why do you believe what you believe? I don't say it's a ministry. Everybody is called to defend the faith. To preach the word in season and out of season. For all of us to always give a defense. Do you understand? Of your hope. I mean, someone should see. Our new sister-in-law, in a not so direct way, mocked the prayer that happened in their house after Pastor William went there. I said, you should not take that. You should defend the faith. After all, hasn't the prayer been done in good, you know, in good, or what is that word? Intentions? Did we come to pray to bring frogs into your house or make something? No, everything was done in good intentions. And it was from God. So something is a problem, maybe it's something else. Don't blame God or the prayer for it. Speak the truth in love. Do you understand? You should have the wisdom of God. And to get that wisdom, you need to know the Bible.